Good morning, everyone. I am Jean-Marc Denis, the Chairman of the Board for the European Processor Initiative. I'm going to talk about the European approach for developing the technologies for high-end computing for the exascale and post-exascale areas that we are foreseeing. And we want to develop our own in-house technology made in Europe for the European supercomputers. So let me tell you how we are going to do that. At first, it's very important to consider that it started back in 2015 from a political initiative by Jean-Claude Juncker, the president of the European Commission. At that time, he explained he wanted to have for Europe one of the top three world supercomputers in regards of the top 500 list in Europe based on European technology in 2020. Obviously, through times, the target for breaking the exascale barrier has moved. So now in Europe, we target 2023. But anyway, the real objective to use European technology and to recreate industrial landscape for developing technologies is a core feature for the evolution of Europe. And this has been translated in real facts. In 2017, the Union, the 27 countries of the Union, joined by external countries like Swiss, like Norway, deciding to create EuroHPC joint undertaking. This organization, located in Europe, has one role. This is to federate the European roadmap, the European strategy for high-performance computing. So, starting EuroHPC, we have moved forward, and now we are moving to a new level of ambition. Ursula von der Leyen, yesterday, I'm talking on September 17th. Ursula von der Leyen explained during the State of the Union that Europe is going to invest 8 billion euros in the next generation of supercomputers. This is amazing. This is big. This is bigger than the US. This is bigger than Japan. And this is likely in the same range as China is doing. And for that, Europe will also invest part of the 8 billion euros in the European industry to develop our next generation microprocessor. And this is very important. It means that over the next decade, because the ambition is for 10 years, Europe will recreate a European industry in the high-end semiconductor segment and also in the high-end microprocessor segment. So companies like Intel, like AMD, or like Huawei, or like Fujitsu, all of them being non-European, will have to face a new competitor located in Europe. And this is something that is absolutely crucial for the future economic sovereignty of the continent. So what is the European Processor Initiative objective? And indeed, from EPI, everything that has been stated at the political level gets a real concrete translation in solutions and products. We are the first step toward the European sovereignty in high-end supercomputer microprocessor segment. So we have to combine totally different objectives with EPI. We have a short-term objective. This is to supply in 2022, 2023, a European design microprocessor to empower the European exascale machines. And Europe will acquire two exascale machines installed in 2023 and 2024, very likely located in Germany and France. And with the short-term objective, we have also to start a long-term road, long-term objective toward a full sovereignty on the complete value chain. Sovereignty means, for this, very specifically, that we don't want to be at risk of limitation or embargo by non-US countries. We want to get access to high-performance, low-power microprocessors from the IP to the products. This is very difficult because we start from a blank page, almost, and we have to recreate teams, we have to recreate technology, competency on the complete value chain. So we have to fulfill those short-term and long-term objectives simultaneously. So when we translate that into technical readiness levels, TRL, it means that for the short term, we have to work with high TRL from 4 to 9 for the microprocessor that will be in the machines in 2023, with low-level TRL for development of research and innovation that will be transformed over time into technology and products. That will take a decade, and this is really a strong ambition where EPI is setting up the foundations. 27 partners are already members of EPI. I will not enter the details of the 27 members. Anyway, I think important to understand the class of partners we have. We have the best research centers in high-performance computing. Let me mention, for instance, the Barcelona Supercomputing Center, the French CEA organization, the German Jülich organization. We also have KIT in Germany. We also have the Technical Lisboa University. We also have the Croatian University. We also have the Institute of Computer Science in Greece, and we also have the best European industry for developing computers, for developing also supercomputers. We have Ethos. We also have semiconductor industries with Infineon, with STMicroelectronics, and we have also car manufacturers in the consortium. And why? Simply because one of the markets we want to address beyond supercomputers is high-end edge computing segment, and more specifically, autonomous vehicles. This is why we have BMW in the consortium, and we also have Electrobit, which is the European designer and the reference company for the embedded software, plus a few others. So all of that combined together, we address the short-term objective for high-end computing, plus a sustainable economical model toward HPC and toward edge computing. So how are we going to articulate the low TRL with the high TRL? How we articulate from the development of IP, so making innovation, to products? This is where we also see the strengths of Europe, because we have created a new company, Cypearl, whose is specifically created to design the product, to manufacture the product that will be located out of Europe, because we need to work with the best-in-class processes, so that will be in Taiwan. And Cypearl will also sell the products, the microprocessors, at first in Europe and also obviously beyond Europe. So Cypearl is incorporated in Europe, that is in France. It's a fabless company, simply because it's not possible we don't have a fab in Europe in 7 nanometers or in 5 nanometers. Cypearl license all the IP from the EPI partners, and Cypearl also start developing its own IP set. And Cypearl will also make the bridge from the innovation from the universities and the HPC research centers to the industry. And all of that is extremely well articulated between fundamental research up to final products available off the shelf. So when we translate this unique combination of short-term objective with long-term objective, this unique combination of research centers and industry into a roadmap. So how does it work? For the short-term objective, we've made a decision which is very indeed rational. This is to work with an IP vendor, Arm. So we acquire licenses from Arm. And more specifically, we work with their Zeus core, which is version 8.x core that is specifically designed for high performance computing. So to some extent, this is an evolution of the core that is used in the Fujitsu A64FX microprocessor. And we use that core, plus obviously many other IP acquired from the field, and we combine them into a common platform that I will more specifically discuss in the next slides. Combined with that, we also have a rock-solid roadmap over a decade based on RISC-V. We develop at first a European accelerator, EPAC, EPAC. So we develop an IP, and we are going to test this IP in 22 nanometers. And we are going also to integrate this IP on the common platform with the Zeus core. And all of that has two roles. At first, to get a general purpose processor based on Zeus. And in second place, to validate in 7 nanometer the RISC-V accelerator IP we are developing. So Cypern will take the common platform, Zeus and EPAC together. We'll make the integration, and we'll manufacture at TSMC in 7 nanometer a product, REA, R-H-E-A, that will be available in volume in 2022. Then, in 2023, the first European exascale machine will be available based on this microprocessor. In parallel, obviously, once the first generation REA processor is designed, there will be a second generation that will come after EPI based on additional funds and projects from Europe, also designed by Cypher, that will use much more recent core from ARM, because we need 2 or 3 generations based on ARM before we can reach autonomy using our own IP for a general purpose processor. And in parallel, we will transform into a product, real accelerator product, the technologies we will have validated in the first generation. And over time, after 2023, let's say 2025, 26, and beyond, up to 2030, we will increase, we will develop our portfolio of IP based on RISC-V up to the moment where we will not need to acquire external IP to get our own European IP and architecture for a general purpose processor. So, having said that, now it's time to talk about the technology and the vision we have for the technology we are going to implement. This section is very important because you will see that the way we have chosen to design our microprocessor in terms of overall architecture comes really for high performance computing specification. We started from the user needs for the future, how it is transformed into a supercomputer architecture, into supercomputer, let's say, server design, and from that into microprocessor design. So we have made some choices, and I'm going to explain what choices we've made for the REA microprocessor. So at first, let's consider that through ages, HPC had a strong breakthrough with the coming of artificial intelligence. So let me explain. Before artificial intelligence, a supercomputer was indeed some class of compute engine. It was a tool where the scientists, the computer scientists with mathematicians, took theoretical models, transformed those models into HPC applications, developed at first in Fortran and then in C, and on machines bigger and bigger. They run those applications from simple data sets or small data sets as input value and got results. With the coming of artificial intelligence, which is indeed a different wording to say statistics, dynamic statistics, and usage of data, of dynamic data, the way we use computers has been dramatically transformed. We have the data, which is the equivalent of the theoretical models. So we have the theoretical models on the first hand, and on the other hand, we have the real data, let's say the experimental model. The big data is analyzed using machine learning, so artificial intelligence to make it simple, which is equivalent to the HPC applications. And then the value chain from data through artificial intelligence is to obtain results. And where it's becoming complex is that the theoretical models can be combined with the experimental models. The HPC applications can be combined with artificial intelligence, so machine learning and with deep learning techniques. And the output of the artificial intelligence can be used to transform the theoretical models or to inject as input value in the HPC applications. And the other way around is also true. So all of that is transformed into a global workflow on a global data flow. And this is the massive evolution that we are forcing in high performance computing. The data are generated in the IoT space. So this is your camera, this is a thermal sensor installed everywhere in the streets. It could be a pollution sensor, it could be a pressure sensor, a wind sensor, making data measure every second. Then it's combined with the edge analysis, so some kind of local computing to filter the data, to improve the quality of the data, and to upscale to the public cloud and to a more global workflow in the supercomputers relevant data. We also have the rise of open and public cloud used as in combination with in-house supercomputers. And this is what we call a complex workflow. And the evolution we are foreseeing in the recent supercomputers, let's say with a Summit machine in the US, with a Sunway Taihu Light in China, and also with the Fugaku machine in Japan, this is to combine all together the data from IoT, from the edge, on the classical supercomputer technologies into complex workflows to generate systems. And something that is very specific and we can note here is that the three machines I mentioned here are strictly equivalent in their nature. I mean that they are homogeneous machines. You could argue that in the Summit machine, you have a combination of Power9 with NVIDIA accelerators. This is true. So this is, at the node level, heterogeneous or hybrid between a CPU and a GPU. But at the global level, at the machine level, this is homogeneous because each and every node is 100% equivalent to the others. And this is exactly the same for the Chinese machine. And obviously, the Fugaku machine is totally homogeneous. And it's even more homogeneous than the two others because there is no accelerator. There is no GPU in the machine simply because the Riken, the Japanese institution who have made the specifications for the Fugaku machine has chosen to have the machine learning techniques embedded in the CPU, which is a difficult choice to make, but it is certainly a very, very good one to simplify the programming model and the complexity for using the machine in the perspective of HPC and artificial intelligence workflows. So this is very interesting, but we believe in Europe that the future machines will be much more complex. What does it mean? In Europe, our approach is to consider that a workflow has different steps. For the first step, you could have a very optimal combination of CPU and accelerator. Let's say this is this one. For the second step of the workflow, a different combination with a CPU plus, let's say, a RISC-V accelerator could make sense. For the third phase of the workflow, combining a CPU with a GPU could be even more optimal. And then we could also consider that a CPU plus an FPGA could be more relevant. So all of that to say that one doesn't fit all. It means that a future exascale and post-exascale supercomputer will be modular. It will contain different modules, one module being at the hardware level different from the other modules. But if we work this way, with different CPUs everywhere, with different accelerators everywhere, not only the system will be very difficult to manage, but the complexity for the programming model, the complexity for developing applications being well optimized for each and every different module will be just impossible for developers. This is why we think that the proper combination is to use the same CPU, so the EPI processor manufactured by Cyper, in all modules. And the difference between the modules is exclusively on the accelerator. And we also believe that if we use the same instruction set for the general purpose processor, which is the same as for the IoT, as for the edge, and as for the public clouds, again, this is a big gain in terms of complexity. It reduces the complexity for the developers. It reduces the complexity for the transfer and translation of the data from one layer to the other, or from one step to the other. So this is why we believe that if we work with ARM instruction set, with ARM tools, from IoT to the data center on the supercomputers, that will dramatically simplify the whole process on the whole workflow. This is the choice we are going to make in Europe for our own microprocessor on supercomputers. So ultimately, that will drive the combination of those heterogeneous and hybrid modules inside the exascale framework, and the users, the end users, developers, and the end users will see a unified environment because there is a single CPU. Through the use of a single CPU, we can use a unified compiler, programming language, and library model, and development tools, and all the environments that developers and end users will have in their hands for working on a day-to-day basis. So their productivity will be improved, and the number of publications and the quality of the results will be improved as well. So in more details, we have now seen that we think that the CPU will have a central place to play in the future exascale machines, while the accelerators will provide the raw computing combination with the CPU for the exascale machines. So what are the consequences of this modular architecture? The first consequence is that the general purpose processors have to be even more open than today. It means the GPP, the general purpose processor, or the CPU, this is different acronym for exactly the same concept, will have to be open to drive different GPUs, let's say from NVIDIA, from AMD. It should also address the possibility to directly connect to FPGAs, let's say from Xilinx, to neuromorphic accelerators, let's say from Graphcore, a UK company, and in the future with cryptographic engines, and why not with quantum accelerators, let's say from Pasqual, which is a European startup who is developing a quantum accelerator. So indeed, the general purpose processor role is to be some kind of data engine where the data flow shouldn't be stopped. It's an integration platform for different accelerators, while the raw compute engine is now in the accelerator area. So this is the car I've chosen to present to explain the concept. That would be very difficult to drive, but it drives extremely fast for a very specific purpose. So NVIDIA GPU is just magic for some class of applications, provided you can transform your application using CUDA. AMD is also working on the world-class accelerator, and we can see the US initiative for the exascale machines using the AMD accelerator, let's say for the frontier machine. Xilinx, Altera provide world-class FPGAs, Graphcore neuromorphic accelerators, Pasqual future quantum accelerators. While they are totally different in nature, all those accelerators have one point in common. They are difficult to use, but when you can port your application and optimize your application with a very significant effort on those hardware, you obtain fantastic results, very fast results. So you have to pay a price, which is the complexity to exceed the technology. So what should we expect from an exascale general purpose processor? At first, it has to be manufactured with the best-in-class process. Right now, this is 7 nanometer, but that will be soon 5 nanometer, and likely tomorrow 4 or even 3 nanometers. It doesn't need to offer the best double precision performance. No, it has to offer excellent double precision performances. So there is no need for the general purpose processor to compete with specialized devices like GPU, for instance. To be very concrete, what does it mean? It means that the Linpack benchmark that is used for the very classical top 500 list doesn't make sense to try to use a general purpose processor to break the performances on Linpack. The role now to run as a Linpack engine is devoted to GPUs. Fair enough, it works well, let's go this way. The general purpose processor has to be extremely flexible and performant regarding external connections. It has to offer best-in-class memory, bandwidth, and performances with HBM, 2E or 3, and in the future even more performant HBM, with DDR5. And then you also need to connect the general purpose, the accelerators. So a very large combination of PCI Express Gen 5 lanes, 416X, 516X, 615X, that kind of huge number of PCI Express Gen 5 16X slots. Plus in the future, CXL, which is some kind of glue to assemble CPUs together to build larger SMP machines. And obviously, to bridge with my description regarding a global exascale environment, the integration for the data flow with IoT, with edge, with data centers on cloud has to be totally transparent. So applications have to be easy to port and optimized to obtain performance on the GPP. This is not that simple, and I will explain you later the consequences. Open source tools have to be used as well. We all know that today, if you want to get an optimal compiler, GCC is not the best choice. But in the future, it should become the best choice. And for that, you need to make some decisions regarding the design of your microprocessor. And the development tools, as a consequence of open source, can be unified as long as this is totally open and works from IoT to the cloud through the data center. So let me give you now something quite maybe difficult to understand in first place, but that is a driving consideration for the European processor. On this chart, you can see on the X axis the air peak, so the peak double precision performances. On the Y axis, the byte per flop ratio, which is how many bytes per flop your system can generate. So the more byte per flop ratio, the more compute you can make, so the more gigaflops or teraflops you can obtain from your CPU. So if we see the trend, let's say for Intel through edges, they have dramatically improved the peak performance. But the price they've paid is to reduce the byte per flop ratio. So it's a great CleanPack engine, but for any class of applications which are much more memory demanding, it's not performing well. On the other hand, you can see, for instance, that AMD is somewhere in the middle with the AMD Naples processor, and with their new ROM processor, they made the choice to keep following the path opened by Intel on going to maximizing the flops, despite it is reducing the byte per flop ratio. Fujitsu has a bit different approach. In the past, with the processor that was in the K supercomputer, they had a huge byte per flop ratio and a low air peak. So it was not very well balanced from this standpoint. The new A64FX processor from Fujitsu is more balanced. It offers a very decent peak performance and a relatively good byte per flop ratio. But this is not perfectly balanced. So if we now define some spaces on this chart, you have unbalanced system with too much memory bandwidth available for the performance you can obtain from the CPU. On the other hand, you also have unbalanced system with too much performance that cannot be used efficiently because you don't have enough memory bandwidth. And then you've got in the middle balanced system. And because we don't want in Europe to design a CleanPack engine, and we want anyway to have a supercomputer processor, we are going to design the microprocessor to balance the peak performance with a very, very good, on the world class, maybe the best in the world, byte per flop ratio. Similarly, the question of the efficiency from your supercomputer is very important. On this chart, you can see the byte per flops ratio on the X axis. On the Y axis, and this is a number difficult to understand as well at the beginning, you've got the HPCG, so the high performance gradient conjugate benchmark efficiency in regards of the peak performance of the microprocessor. So you can see that the recent systems, so the Sunway machine, the Supermoog machine in Europe, which was the largest in Europe at that time, and you've got the Trinity machine, offer an efficiency on HPCG, which is dramatically below 2% of the peak performance. To some extent, it's insane. Those machines are very, very expensive, very big. They consume a lot of electrical power, and the efficiency you obtain is a few percent, one digit percent of the peak performance. You have wasted your money for nothing. On the other hand, when you look at back in the past, the Key supercomputer in 2011, the efficiency was much better, 5 times more better than the most recent supercomputers in the top 500, but still quite low. And when you look at the trend for all those machines, you obtain this this scale. Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention the Fugaku machine, which is not so efficient on FPCG. So from this standpoint, you can ask a very simple question. How do I obtain performances for the money I have spent for my supercomputers? So why memory bandwidths and byte-per-flop ratio matter? Just because this is the only way to be efficient, and this is the only way to be more to get more from your very expensive supercomputer. And again, the choice we are making in Europe, this is to have a very efficient general purpose processor for we can reach high efficiency in regards of the HPCG efficiency benchmark. So from all those considerations, so architecture and performance, we have designed this architecture. So we have a concept of common platform. I already have mentioned at the beginning of this talk. The common platform is indeed a multi-die, multiple chiplet, and some kind of floor plan on which we plug different complex IP blocks. ARM, Zeus, microprocessor, and the concept of the European accelerator, FPGAs, a specific accelerator, some automotive. Here, this is the MPPA from Calre, cryptographic engines, and so on and so forth. And because data matters, and we need to make this CPU a totally transparent data engine, we are going to have a very significant quantity of HBM2E memory stack, plus also a very significant quantity of DDR5 memory lanes, plus a massive number of PCI Express Gen 5 lanes, plus CCIX and CXL in the future lanes as well, and obviously a totally unique feature for die-to-die connection. If you want to know more about the Rea microprocessor we are designing, I suggest you get in touch with Cyper, the European industrial hand for EPI, that will be very happy to disclose to you the detailed specification of the microprocessor. So it's time now to conclude this presentation. What are the perspectives and challenges for the future? At first, EPI delivers. Let's consider this is a big success. The first success is to have rebuilt in Europe the expertise for developing high-end and complex processing units. And this has been achieved after decades of disinvestment in this area. We are going to have in the European exascale supercomputers in 2023 the European accelerator. This is a big achievement as well. So we'll be ready to move to the next step, which is to engage on the road for developing our own IP for general purpose processor in the high-end area. But the world is changing. We see that the instruction set on which we have decided to leverage our first generations is ARM, and ARM just has been acquired by NVIDIA. Does it change something? Is it neutral? Let's wait for at least 18 months. The US regulation, the European regulation, the Japanese regulation, Chinese and Korean regulations, and a few others will have to approve the deal. So we have time. Anyway, for at least for the two first generations of microprocessors we are designing, it's going to have absolutely no consequence. On the longer term, we think it could conclude with a unique combination from data creation in the cloud and in the ARM layers through the workflows up to supercomputers and public clouds with the ARM artificial intelligence IP combined with the ARM IPs. So that would be a combination between general purpose processor IP with the world-class artificial intelligence IPs from NVIDIA, with obviously a unified environment at the software level from IoT to supercomputers. That could drive the computer industry and the IT industry in general to a new level where everyone can leverage on those very standard on best on world-class IP for all their applications. So I want to thank you for the time you have spent with me today. I know this is a very special moment in the HPC industry. I know that because we are not together, you couldn't ask any question you want, and I couldn't answer any question you have. But feel free to contact me. You've got my details at the beginning of the talk. And obviously, you can contact me through the social networks with Twitter, with LinkedIn. And we have our social medias with our website and our YouTube channel. So thank you very much and hope that this presentation was interesting enough. Thank you again.